you, Taryan and family, for leading us an opening song, and also thank you, Roy Engel, for leading us in prayer. So as Roy Engel remembered in his prayer about regaining the lost identity of the Marthoma Church, or regaining the restoring the lost identity of the Marthoma Church. So what we are doing, the exercise is all about what is that lost identity? Is there an identity at all for the Malankara Church? So that is why I'm taking too much time on pondering on the St. Thomas period, that is AD 5 to 1500. So this today and next class, we are going to look upon factors that were led to two independent movements to regain the lost identity of the Marthoma Church, or to preserve the autonomy of the church. So autonomy in the sense, autonomy in the doctrines, autonomy in the faith and practices. Second, autonomy of the administration. So the Malankara Church, from which the Marthoma Church emerged, we had a given autonomy. Autonomy in faith and doctrines, as well as autonomy in its administrative structure. So if you understand that part, so without have a knowledge of the St. Thomas period, you cannot mark, you cannot define, you cannot understand the Marthoma Church. So today, we will look into the first independent movement, that is the Kunan Cross Oath. The second independent movement is the Reformation, the Marthoma Church, initiated by Abraham Malpan in 1836. So 1653 Kunan Cross Oath and 1836 Reformation of the Malankara Church, those are the main two events that help us to regain the already existed identity of the Malankara Church. So first we want to look up, this is a comparative study, as you see on the screen, St. Thomas period. I said that there are there cannot be any evidence nor objective evidences that St. Thomas did come. But the Malankara Church cherish, hold on to a culture, hold on to faith and practices that was inherited from St. Thomas. So that is a St. Thomas tradition. It went uninterrupted up to 1500 AD, even though we had friendly relationship with the Persian church or the East Syrian church. The bishops, clergy used to come to the present Kerala those times, and the Christian migration was there. They settled in around Chavakkad, Cochin, those areas, and also in Koyilon. There are historical evidences are there. So quickly we are going to a comparative study of the St. Thomas period as well as the Portuguese period. The first, the St. Thomas Christians up to 1500 AD, they accept the apostolate of St. Thomas. Whereas the Portuguese, they insisted to accept apostolate of St. Peter. So this is the problem. These are the issues. While we look into this, these are the issues that led to the convening of Diamber Synod, Udayambayur Synod. These are the things that led to ultimately convening the Diamber Synod in 1599 by the Archbishop of Goa, Roman Catholic Church, Alex D. Menezes. So St. Thomas, Christians accepted apostolate Thomas, but the Portuguese, the Roman Catholics They do not accept that. They insisted that on apostolate of St. Peter. Second, the ecclesiastical language at that time was Syriac. Aradhana Pasha. We had a liturgy, not the St. James liturgy. Malangara Taksa was there. Maybe ascribed to Abdai and Mari. A-D-H-A-I, Abdai, M-A-R-I, Mari. That is a Taksa that was used. So ecclesiastical language was Syriac for the St. Thomas Christians, whereas the ecclesiastical language of the Roman Church was Latin. So it was a clash between the languages, whether to accept Syriac or whether to accept Latin. As I said last class, these are divine languages. The Syrian Christians think that Syriac is the divine language. For the Roman Catholics, it is Latin. For the Muslims, it is Arabic. For the Hebrews, for the Jewish people, Hebrew. That was there, no? So, Roman Catholics insisted that if at all you are continuing in worshipping God, then it should be in Latin. So instead of Syriac, they tried to impose Latin. Then there was a taksa called Malangara Taksa. As I said, it was Adai Mari Taksa. Again, it is believed that Adai and Mari are disciples of St. Thomas. So this Malangara Taksa, the modern version, are used by the Kalyan Church in Thrissur, led by Marapre. So instead of Malangara Taksa, they imposed the Latin liturgy. Then evangelization was not a colonial agenda. As you all know, colonialism started only in 15th century or 16th century. Portugal and Spain were the maritime nations at that time. When you read history, the then Pope has divided the whole world into two half. One part has given to the Pope, King of Portugal. The other parts given to the King of Spain. Then they colonized the whole world. All world means wherever they colonized them. So evangelization is not what Jesus said, go and make disciples of the nation. It's not like that. The religion of the colonized the people, whether it is Spain or Portugal, their religion is Roman Catholicism. So they want to impose that. Whereas in AD, up to AD 500, the Syrian Christians came. They are not colonial agents. They just preached the gospel. So a drastic difference was there. Evangelization was not a colonial agenda for the Persian Christians or the St. Thomas Christians. So they do not impose that religion upon the native people, the present-day Christian Kerala. But Kerala-thile janangalde mugalil Christian conversion illa. Aggressive conversion was not there before the coming of the Portuguese. But the Portuguese presented it as a colonial agenda. I think that I already conveyed to you two methods, two prominent methods they did to spread the Christianity was, one is forced marriage, then forced conversion. By forced marriage, a population was there, they got the newborn babies were there, they automatically become Christians. In that way, by marrying the native women through that wedlock, a community was came and that they became automatically Christians. The second is forced conversion. They forced the military, they forced the people to accept the gospel, accept Jesus Christ, not out of love, but compulsion was there. So that was the main thing. The third, gospel message incarnated in Indian soil. That means during the St. Thomas period, the gospel has the ability to incarnate. That means the St. Thomas Christians or the Persian Christians did not think that not superstitious. That is why I said the kudumi, using of the elephant for the procession. All those things were there. But for the Portuguese, these are superstitions, the religious forms of the, not only in India, wherever the Western missionaries went, they had an unsympathetic attitude towards religious forms and cultures of the native people, the receptive people. So the receptive culture looked as superstitious. Then the St. Thomas period, they respected the faith and religious practices of the natives. As I said, the privileges were there. There is no clash of religion, clash of culture. They existed side by side. Whereas in the Portuguese period, religious forms and cultures of the non-Christians, they considered as superstitions, and they forced Christians to remove all those superstitious practices from the church. Then the St. Thomas Christians maintained its autonomy in its administration through the archdeacon from the Paulometum family. They were elected from Paulometum family. In native language, it is Jadhika Kartavyan, or then they got the archdeacon. So archdeacon was the metropolitan at that time. There is no bishop there. Even though Persian bishops came to Kerala, but they have no jurisdictional authority over the Indian church. The administration of the St. Thomas Christian was vested under archdeacon or Jadhika Kartavyan. Then the faith and practice, as I said, we will come to what are them. But they cannot accept archdeacon as the, even he is not a clergy at all. Clergy, I don't know, but the vestments are look like the ordinary person. So when they came to the church, so they wanted to impose Roman papacy. So intolerance. That is why by seeing all these things that are different from the Roman Catholic Church, that is why they convened the Diamber Synod and forced St. Thomas Christians to accept Roman faith, supremacy of the Pope, and all those things were imposed. Then, free of the control of the hierarchy. Hierarchy means the Syrian bishops, you know, the East Syrian bishops used to come to Kerala, and they are not ruled by East Syrian church. Never ever, please note, never ever the Malangara church was under the control of any foreign church. The administration was strictly under the Indian hands. It was controlled by the archdeacon, a member from the Malangara church. But the Portuguese imposed the supremacy of the Pope through the Diamber Synod. Then, neither adhere to the faith and doctrines of any other churches, nor dependent upon any churches, and that I have already explained. But the Portuguese could not accept it. They have a crusading spirit. We historians say crusading spirit. What is a crusading spirit? That means you impose your culture, your language, your thought patterns on the receptive nations. Because after all, the conquered land was colony. So they are supposed to accept their religion, their culture, their language. So they could not appreciate or accept the native religions or native practices. They could not accept it. So what are the, I'm writing all this in negative, you know. There is nothing called a transubstantiation, no knowledge of transubstantiation. Transubstantiation means when the wine and the bread was consecrated in the Holy Qurbana, the Roman Catholic doctrine was transubstantiation. Vastumatu anuvare. The bread changed to be flesh and the wine turned to be blood. And in the St. Thomas period, there is nothing that, there is no change of elements. Then the presence of Jesus Christ was there on the elements. Then they condemned the adoration of image. No images you can find in the St. Thomas period in the churches. No images, no veneration is there. No knowledge of the intercession of saints. I'm talking about the St. Thomas Christians up to 1500. no knowledge of the intercession of saints. Belief in purgatory was not there. Purgatory means after our death, we will end up in between the heaven and earth, and there, that is the area of purification. The fire was there. So after the purification, you will enter into the heaven. And that idea or that doctrine was made only after the coronation of the Gregory I, that is the Pope I. Masses means Holy Qurbana for the prayer and prayers for the dead. It was not there. No extreme unction was there. For all questions of doctrine, they took the authority of the scripture as decisive. There is no celibacy at all. All the priests are married. There is nothing called celibacy of the priest. Another thing, no auricular confession. A-U-R, auricular, C-I, A-U-R-I-C-U-L-A-R, and I mistakenly not printed over it. Auricular confession means you personally go to a priest and tell all your sins committed. Rahasya Kumbhasaram nu parayum. In the Marthoma Church or the Malankara Church, there is no such practice called auricular confession. Now our church has public confession. Those who are participating in the Holy Qurbana, they will stand in their place and make the confession public. So that was the practice of the Marthoma Church or the St. Thomas Christians. But the Portuguese imposed the Roman Catholic faith and practices. Okay, for that we will say Latinization of the St. Thomas Christians. Latinization means adhering to or forcing them to accept Latin liturgy and the faith and doctrines of the Roman Catholic Church. And Portuguese and its attempt to Latinize the St. Thomas Christians. So I'm not elaborating that. Our directory that was published by the history book published by the our church contains all these things. So these are the things. Dying Presented in 1599, the St. Thomas Christians, they are not willing to accept the claims of Portuguese. They resisted. So in order to make them accept the Roman doctrines, Archbishop Menezes, Alex D. Menezes, convened a council at Synod at Udaimperu or Dayambar in 1599 and forced the Christians, Syrian Christians, Malankara Christians to accept the imposed Roman Catholic doctrines. They imposed the Latin liturgy. Okay, next slide. Next slide, so many. Okay, so the first independence movement of Malankara Christians. As I said, the Malankara Christians, the identity was autonomy in faith, in doctrines, and in administration. So they cannot accept the Roman Catholic doctrines. So I'm not going to go into details about them. In a brief way, I will say that. No. After the Dayambar Synod in 1599, the St. Thomas Christians wrote to other churches, to the Patriarch of Antioch, Patriarch in Jerusalem, to send bishops to help them. But these Portuguese people did two things. First thing, they imposed Roman Catholicism on the St. Thomas Christians. Second, a travel blockade on foreign bishops. Videsha Rajyathunnum, Bishopammar Achanmar India varadirikkanayitte, avaru ban cheythu. There is a ban on the bishops coming to India or to Kerala. So one such bishop named Ahatullah, he landed Cochin. So on hearing that bishop came, the rumor is that one is he was drowned by the Portuguese soldiers in Cochin, that sea. Some say that he was deported to Goa. Anyway, the Syrian, the Malankara Christians, hearing the news that a bishop, a Syrian bishop, who came to them to save them from this this problem, to rescue them, was drowned either in Cochin or he was deported to Goa. So they all gathered near a church in Mattanchery, that is again in Cochin. A cross was there. They tied ropes on the cross, and holding the ropes, they took an oath renouncing the Roman Catholic doctrines. And they said that we will remain as independent Marthoma Christians or Malankara Christians. So in 1953, Syrian Christians, those opposed the Latinization of the church, took an oath renouncing Roman connection. And they regain the lost identity. They remained as an independent church, holding the faith of ancient St. Thomas Christians. Please remember these things. They remained as an independent church, holding the faith of the Christian St. Thomas Christians. Two sections emerged in the undivided Malankara Church after 1653 Kunan Cross Oath. One faction, that is the minority, holding the Syrian Christian identity, majority went with Roman Catholic faith. So, 1 minute. The ancient St. Thomas Christians remained independent and elected their own bishops called Marthomas. So 12 bishops, there is no bishop at all. So 12 priests, they elevated Archdeacon Thomas as by 12 priests after the Kunan Cross event. 32 parishes joined with Marthoma first. So many other yeah. 12 priests after Kunan Cross Oath event, they elected Marthoma first. His consecration was not valid because priests cannot consecrate a bishop. A bishop can only consecrate a bishop. Unfortunately, there is no bishop at all. So as they forced by the circumstances, 12 priests together elevated Archdeacon Thomas, their leader, as the Marthoma first. The Roman Catholics and other, they mocked and St. Thomas Christian that no, your bishop is not valid, his consecration is not valid. So they were very sad about these things. And that they are waiting for a Syrian bishop to validate his consecration. So upon getting the letter from the Malankara Church, again, another bishop came. 1665, Mark Gregorios, a Jacobite metropolitan under the Antiochian Patriarch, arrived in Malabar. So this is the third stream that flowed into the river of St. Thomas Christians. First, Persian Christians. Second, Portuguese. And through them, the Roman Catholic. Then we come into a contact with Jacobite Christianity under the Antiochian Patriarch. Mark Gregorios, Bishop Mark Gregorios, validated the episcopal consecration of Marthoma first, Archdeacon Thomas. So his apostle succession was validated by Mark Gregorios. And through the connection with the Antiochian Church, Jacobite Church, we received the St. James liturgy, which we used the revision of that one, that liturgy are currently used by Marthoma Church. So St. James liturgy was brought by Jacobite Church. So we will then going to 12 priests. Okay. So then connection with the Anglicans. I'm skipping the history. I don't want to go into details of all what has happened, but many very, very important things that were relevant to our study. So then the fourth stream is connection with Anglican Church. Let me repeat again. First Persian Church, then Roman Catholic Church, then JKV Church. Fourth one is Anglicans. Anglicans came because India became under the British Raj, British rule. The British people are Anglicans. They are Protestants. So the British government or the British in India, they allow evangelization in their colonized areas. In that those time, the colonies or the stations were Calcutta, Mumbai, Madras, Ipa Chennai, then of course in Travancore, Kerala. So those are the Sundays where British were present. So let me repeat: Calcutta, Mumbai, Madras, including Kerala. So the Protestant Christianity flourished in these Sundays. Please remember, around Calcutta, around Mumbai, around Madras. Only a few years later, the Protestant Christianity make its roads into the inner India, including Delhi. And that is not our concern here. I will explain it in another class. Okay, 19th century, India became under the British Empire. Okay, the non-Roman sections of St. Thomas Christians came into contact with the Church Missionary Society. How they came? See, the while the British people, when they traveled to colonize different countries, the British chaplains were also with them. One such chaplain was Claudius Buchanan. He was a very good person, an evangelical in spirit. So the Britishers, they knew that a Christian church was there in Kerala. Their main idea was this church, they wanted to revive the St. Thomas Christians in Kerala, and they want to use that community to spread the gospel within India. So after the reforming the St. Thomas Christians in Kerala, they can be helpful for the British to spread Christianity in India. So they were very much fond of the Christian community in Kerala, because a British resident was stationed in Kerala, in Malabar, in Madras, in under the Madras regiment. A resident was there in Travancore. Okay, so through that church missionary society, St. Thomas Christians came into contact with Protestant Christianity. So thus there is a contact within Church of England. Okay, the Church of England, the Church Missionary Society was interested. I'm skipping. If you have my book, so I will make available my book in my dissertation, the detailed study about Claudius Buchanan, how he contacted the Malankara Christians. So all those things are there. So that is, I leave for your reading. So Colonel Munro was the British resident at that time. He was a good Christian, very sympathetic to Malankara Christians. He wanted to revive the Malankara Christians. So the British resident, for the training of the clergy of the Malankara Church, he built a seminary in Kottayam in 1815 at Kottayam to train candidates for clergy, for priesthood. Colonel Munro and the CMS chaplain, Reverend Cole Claudius Buchanan, had requested the CMS to send a mission of help to Malankara. So a mission of help arrived First Thomas Norton 1816, followed by Benjamin Bailey 1816, Joseph Finn in 1818, Henry Baker in 1819. Okay, so when the mission of help arrived, what is the spiritual life of St. Thomas Christians? A vibrant church during 1500 up to 1500 AD, a vibrant church, a church which was very strictly followed the biblical doctrines. When the CMS missionaries arrived, 19th century, the life of the St. Thomas Christians was very pathetic, very pathetic. What are the reasons? The spiritual life of the Marthoma Christians in Kerala was at a low level. Public worship was conducted in the Syriac language. That means nobody knows what, how they worship, what they are reciting in the worship. So it was Syriac. The Bible was also in Syriac. People lost the vibrancy. Bible was not translated into vernacular. So it was not available for public readership. Okay, the Malankara Metropolitan, Chepatmar Dionysius, he allowed the Church Missionary Society missionaries to visit parishes and preach the gospel in order to revive the church. Benjamin Bailey engaged in biblical translation. Joseph Finn, he concentrated in seminary education. So, next slide. Next slide, Upakota. Yeah. Henry Baker School, Baker Memorial School, Kottayathippulundu. Baker Memorial School, then this Benjamin Bailey, we cannot forget this missionary. Benjamin Bailey was the one who translated the Syriac Bible into Malayalam. So the first New Testament translation of the Bible made into full by this Benjamin Bailey in 1825. So last class, when after the class, Sarasu has sent me a 1829. Yeah, Sarasu has sent me a WhatsApp message saying that translation made from Syriac Bible, Peshitta, that was taken by Claudius Buchanan to England, but never returned to us. So in page number 25 of our history book, the Singapore history book, the picture of that Peshitta Bible was there. So this Bible is available at Cambridge University website. If you go to Cambridge University website, you can have, you can see this Peshitta Bible. If you visit England, you can also see that Bible. It is preserved there. Then if you go to the Kerala archives, then you will get the Ramban Bible. That is the Bible, the whole Bible translated into Malayalam, handwritten Bible, Ramban Bible, the Peshitta Bible, it was the translation from the Peshitta Bible. So New Testament was translated, the full New Testament translation, as you see, 1829, the whole Bible was translated into 1841. So the Holy Spirit helped the Malankara Christians to have this Holy Bible. In their lifetime, they are first going to read a Bible in their vernacular. In the previous years, they have no connection with the Bible. It was read in English, though in Syria. The ecclesiastical language, the liturgical language was English. Though the people were worshipping God or attending worship without knowing what they are worshipping, what they are believing. So the Bible were received. So once they received the Bible, once they started to read the Bible, then they came to know about their pathetic condition. So the mission of help worked with two aims. Their aim was not to split the church. Their aim was not to replace the Malankara church with the Protestant church. No. Those missionaries had no such aim. Their aim was to revive, please listen, to revive and to reform the Syrian church. Let me again Their aim was to revive and reform the Syrian church and to spread the evangelical faith among the people of Kerala. Let me repeat, the Mission of Help worked with the aim to revive and to reform the Syrian church and to spread evangelical faith among the people of Kerala. Okay, the first batch of missionaries were very wise people, because for centuries they have no idea about the Bible, the biblical doctrines. It was there in the 1500 AD up to, but it was contaminated by Roman Catholic and Jacobite faith and practices. So the first batch of missionaries was friendly with the bishops. Bishop means Dionysius IV, Chepat Mar Dionysius became metropolitan. He had never been friendly with the missionaries, and missionaries in turn took some hasty decisions which widened the dissensions. During his period, tension developed between him and the missionaries and later led to open dispute. 1825, Dionysius became as a metropolitan. During his period, tension developed because of the spread of evangelical faith. They questioned the faith and practices that were in the church, and they said that it was superstitions, do not conform to biblical doctrines. So tensions were emerged. So let me stop here. Then next class, we will go into the reformation of the Marthoma Church, and I think we can stop the first part of the class by next Friday. So questions? Any questions or clarifications up to this point?